Hi there, I'm Todd Lee. Welcome to World History with Lee. Today's topic is India, the subcontinent, and its people. Before we get into that, real quick, if you want to follow along at home, all you need to do is visit my website, mrleet.weebly.com. That's Mr. Leet, all together, one word, .weebly.com. Point your browser to that location, mrleet.weebly.com. You'll come to my homepage. All you need to do is click on the top for World History 1, and there you will find all the material for my World History 1 course. Today, we'll be following standard World History 1.4, B, C, and D for the Virginia Standards of Learning. Come down to World History 1.4 B, C, D. You will find the PowerPoint that I'll be going over, and then you can download the notes as well if you're in the mood to, you know, take some notes as if you were sitting in my class. So, let's get into today's topic, India, the subcontinent, and its people. When India started as a culture thousands of years ago, it wasn't organized into countries like we think of them today, with borders and flags and governments, but rather it was just a loose association of people who happened to live in a region. Now today, those regions actually make up three different countries. Today, the countries of India, Pakistan, and Bangladesh make up what was at one point ancient India. So we say that India is considered to be a subcontinent of Asia, which means it's located, you know, in Asia, but is kind of like below the bulk of the Asian continent. So the way I kind of liken it is, you know, if you have a basement, what's below the basement? The sub-basement, you know? When you're putting together a house, below the floor is the subfloor. You know, what way do people travel through cities? Through the subway. Sub is a prefix that we put on words that means beneath or below. So a subcontinent, in this case of India here, is like a piece of land that's large enough to be a continent on its own, because India is very large, but it's below the bulk of the main continent, which in this case is Asia. So if we look at my little zoomed out photo here up top, this is all Asia rolling across the top here. This is India. This is what this box located here really is. So you can take a look. You've got India, and then to the west is the country of Pakistan, and then to the east is the country of Bangladesh. These three countries together make ancient India. These are today the countries of Pakistan, India, and Bangladesh, but this is the entire area that we will consider to be ancient India for our purposes today. So, just like all the other places we've talked about, ancient India pops up along rivers for the same reason that all these other civilizations need rivers. You need water to drink. You need water for your animals, you need water for your crops, you need some forms of transportation and maybe fish, but those are really secondary and tertiary reasons. Really, you need it because the waters of the rivers are going to flood, and that flooding is going to lead to fertile crops and soil. So, you know, the waters flood, and then you leave all this dirt and silt on the ground, and that refertilizes the soil year after year after year, so you can continue to grow there. So the first civilizations in India, they pop up along the banks of the river that's called the Indus. This is the river that gives the people of India their name, the Indus River. Next, the civilization spreads along to the Ganges River. The Ganges and the Indus are actually pretty close, so sometimes we kind of think of these two rivers and the land that surrounds it as kind of one. But you can see that the Indus here is in the west, and today it flows through the country that would be Pakistan. The Ganges is to the east. It actually flows entirely through the country that is today India. But again, as we mentioned on the first slide, this area in the ancient times is all India. Whether today we've broken it up into different countries, that's immaterial. So civilization starts along the Indus River, the river that gives the Indian country and its people its name, and then it spreads along to the Ganges. These rivers are great places to live because they flood and they provide good soil and ground for you to do all your farming. So we take a look here. This map is kind of pulled out. And we look at the geography. So India itself is surrounded by three sides of water, so that makes it a peninsula itself. Indian Ocean is here, the Arabian Sea is Indian Ocean, the two. And then the country itself has got these two main rivers. So you've got the Indus River flowing in this direction and the Ganges River flowing here. These two areas make up what's called the Indo-Gangetic Plain. So it's a flat area that floods a lot, but as a result of its constant flooding, it gives that soil that refreshing that it always needs every single year. We've talked about it before. You know, if you farm on a piece of land every single year, then the result is you're going to kill the soil. So by flooding on a regular basis and replenishing the soil with the nutrients that the flooding leaves behind, then the result is you've got a piece of land that you can farm on consistently year after year, and that gives you a good place to live. All right, and in relationship to the other ancient river valley civilizations we talk about, India is, it's right in there. So we've already talked about Mesopotamia with the Tigris and the Euphrates rivers. Then we move on to Egypt, and its only river is the Nile. And now we're talking about India with the Indus and the Ganges. So they're all kind of in a row. We don't go quite in order: Mesopotamia, Egypt, then India. But they're all relatively along the same latitude. They're all in the same area within the world. Ancient India, if you were going to live in the past, was probably one of the safest places that you could have been with regard to invasion or warlike people coming by and killing you, because invasion was really, really difficult in India thanks to its physical barriers. So India is a peninsula, so it's surrounded by water on three sides by the aptly named Indian Ocean, so that makes it easy. So the ocean means that there's a great distance between India and any other major landforms. So getting to India by sea for invasion is very difficult, and it's not really done. So you're good on three of your sides because you don't have to worry about invasion that way. And to the north, the northeast and the northwest, India is kind of closed in by mountain ranges. So there's two mountain ranges in India that you have to know. One is called the Himalayan Mountains, and the other is called the Hindu Kush. So if we look here, they kind of make like a triangle to kind of close off the top of India. So in this case here, the Hindu Kush runs in this direction, and the Himalayas run in this direction. So by the Hindu Kush and the Himalayan Mountains meeting each other basically here and closing off the top of India and the bottom of India on three sides being surrounded by water, that makes this a fairly safe place for you to live. So people don't come rolling through here and invading all the time and causing war, like in Mesopotamia. Mesopotamia has these really large, flat, open plains that are very easy for armies to move across. What you have to remember is that when you want to invade someone, you don't just like go there and fight them. You got to bring everything with you. So you got to bring all your weapons with you. You got to bring all your supplies. You got to bring people who actually like do your laundry and cook for you. So it's more than just the soldiers. It's wagons, it's all the supplies. It's very, very difficult to move that number of people across an ocean like the Indian Ocean or over mountains. So the Indian people really stay undisturbed for a very, very long time. This makes it a safe place to be, with the exception of one thing: the weather. That's one thing you can't control. The weather is really your biggest danger here, the flooding and stuff. We'll talk about that here in a minute. But if you're worried about getting murdered, if you're worried about invaders coming in and killing you or making you a slave, India's really not a place where that's a giant concern like it would be in Mesopotamia. So India, rather safe because you're locked in on three sides to the south by water because it's a peninsula, so you're surrounded by the Indian Ocean. But then to the north, you're surrounded by two mountain ranges, the Hindu Kush and the Himalayan Mountains, which are the tallest mountains in the world. So that makes getting over them almost impossible. So we'll look at the Himalayas first. So the Himalayas are the tallest mountains in the world. Down at the bottom right-hand corner, you'll just see some examples of those mountains. Very, very tall, pointy peaks that are very difficult to traverse. So, if you wanted to bring an army of a couple thousand guys across there, you'd not only be bringing them, but you'd be bringing horses, and you'd be bringing weapons and wagons and food, because as we learn later in history, an army marches on its stomach. You got to bring enough food so these guys don't starve to death. And if you just look at those mountains, that's just not something that's going to be very practical. You really can't bring an army over mountains that are just that tall and steep. The top right-hand picture kind of shades in the area and shows you the run of the Himalayan Mountains. That basically is the entire top side of India to the north and the east. So, the result of that is they're kind of locked in. So we already said on the bottom, to the south, they're surrounded by water, the Indian Ocean. To the top, they're surrounded by these mountains, the Himalayas. So people don't want to go in that direction. The tallest mountains in the world are the Himalayas. The tallest mountain itself, Mount Everest, is in the Himalayas, 29,029 feet. That's how tall Mount Everest is. So for my Page County students, the tallest mountain that we have here in Page County is 4,050 feet. That mountain is called Hawksbill Mountain. So if you were to be driving into Stanley on Route 340, right when you get into town and you can see the mountains, dead ahead of you, the tallest one that is, right in front of you, that's Hawksbill, 4,050 feet. So if you were to stack Hawksbill Mountains upon themselves, you'd have to put over 7 of them on top of each other, one after another, in order to get to Mount Everest. That's an incredibly tall mountain. So if you wanted to go hike Hawksbill, you could do it in a day, no problem. But, you know, bringing an entire army and their supplies over something, you know, like Mount Everest, I mean, that's just impossible. It just can't be done. That's what gives India this safety, this level of safety that they don't have to worry about being invaded constantly with people rolling in and killing them and taking their stuff. So India's a pretty safe place to be. The Himalayas are a big part of that. Now, that's not to say no one comes to India. I mean, obviously, there's people there. They had to get there somehow. And that's because the easiest way to get in there is through the Hindu Kush Mountains. So if we look at our map here, the Himalayas that we just talked about roll through here. Very tall, very steep, very difficult to get through. However, this mountain right here, the Hindu Kush, which are smaller both in length and in height, give you the opportunity to sneak into India in smaller numbers. So people do migrate into India, obviously. There's people there. They do so through these things called mountain passes. So a mountain pass is a point which the mountain kind of breaks and is not quite as high up in elevation and is a lot easier to traverse or get through. So, for example, I'll use my own school district here in Page County, Virginia. You know, we are surrounded by mountains on two sides. You know, we've got Massanutten on one side, and then we've got the Blue Ridge Mountains on the other. So in Page County, there are two mountain passes that we have the ability to use to get in and out of our county. And those are points where the mountain kind of dips down and allows you an easier path up and over. That's a mountain pass. So India has mountain passes through the Hindu Kush. So these are points where the mountain elevation is a little bit lower and a little bit easier to get through, not quite as steep, and you can get through. Now, the good thing about mountain passes are that they're good for regular people to kind of come in and go, but they're still, you know, a little bit difficult if you want to bring an entire army through. So what that result is that people are able to kind of come through, but you still don't get giant armies rolling through that area. So mountain passes through the Hindu Kush are people's entry point into the Indian subcontinent. So we've talked about the safety. It's safe because to the south, they're surrounded by water on three sides because the subcontinent of India is a peninsula. So you're surrounded by the Indian Ocean to the south. To the north, you're locked in with two mountain chains, the Himalayan Mountains and the Hindu Kush. And the Hindu Kush, that allows your entry and your exit because they've got these mountain passes. Mountain passes are a big part of this lesson because they're what allow people to get in. And that's what, you know, kind of creates these people that we're talking about here. They migrate in through mountain passes. So the two main rivers that we have to know for India are the Indus and the Ganges. So taking a look on the left map, the highlighted river there is the Indus. Okay, now it has some tributaries that flow off of it and onto it, but this is the main river that the Indian culture starts around. It's in this zone, the Indus River, where things start. On the right-hand side, we've got the Ganges River. Now, the Ganges is the secondary river in India where culture also surrounds itself. And you can see it flowing in this direction here, and it too has lots of rivers that flow into and out of it as well. So the Indus and the Ganges. These are the two main rivers in India. So, you know, every civilization we talk about has at least one or two rivers, but you have to know the Indus and the Ganges. So the Indus is the one that is to the left or the west, and the Ganges is the one that is to the east or the right. However it is that you have to remember this, get it done. This is the Indus and this is the Ganges. These are the two rivers upon which all Indian civilization pretty much revolves itself. So what we've said is that India is a safe place for you to live. You don't have to worry about getting constantly invaded by your neighbors as if you lived in Mesopotamia, where there's armies rolling across the open plains, killing each other all the time. You could wake up in the morning and end up dead by night. Not the case in India, because they're locked in on three sides to the south by water, the Indian Ocean, and those mountains that we talked about lock in the top. So that's going to result in less invasion, less chance of you dying in warfare. And that's good. It's a fairly safe place for those purposes to live. However, there are still challenges. There's no perfect place in the world to live. These are the drawbacks of India. So while they've got the two rivers, the two main rivers, the Indus and the Ganges, that are good places to live because they provide you a constant source of fresh water. They constantly flood on a predictable basis. So you know when they'll flood. You know, during the rainy season they'll flood, and during the dry season they won't. So you can count on when they will flood and when they won't. And that flooding is important for your soil. Obviously it replenishes the topsoil and gives you good nutrients so you can grow there every year. And that's good. The problem is when it does flood, it floods very, very badly. And that's because the majority of the areas where people live, meaning the bulk of the population lives along the rivers, and most of that river area is very, very low-lying. So if it even gets just a little bit of rain, it'll flood. And when it floods very, very vastly over long distances and puts a lot of people underwater. So if we look at this map here, this map shows elevation. So places that are the highest in elevation are gray and white. So for example, you know, most of this area here, Himalayan mountains. So it's very, very gray, high in elevation. Here are the highest peaks here in the Himalayas, where you see like the brightest of the whites, right? Going in the opposite direction, the very, very lowest line areas are the darkest of the greens, okay? And then everything else in between is yellow and brown. So look here, Bangladesh, and this is kind of the area where the Ganges terminates, and then over here where the Indus is, this is very low line as well with the dark green. So the dark green means low line. So that means there's not a lot of hills, there's not a lot of areas where you can escape flooding. It's very flat land, so the river floods a little bit, boop, the whole area gets covered in water. There's this area here in the middle of India called the Deccan Plateau. A plateau is a higher raised area of land, and that, you know, that's a safer place to be, but you don't get as much, you know, that good water as you do through the Indus Valley or through the Ganges Valley. So as a result of its low-lying area, it floods a lot, and when it does, it can cause devastation, it can cause death. So your trade-off is, you know, you can live in, you know, Mesopotamia and not have to worry about flooding that will result in death, but you have to worry about constantly getting invaded by neighbors. In India, you don't have to worry about that as much, but you do have to worry about the waters of the rivers flooding and then that killing you. So there's no perfect place in the world to live. Still, India, not bad. I'd, you know, prefer to be, you know, not murdered in my sleep, but at the same time, there's definitely some challenges with living here. All right, so let's take some photos. Now, these are obviously modern-day photos. We're not taking a look at something from thousands of years ago, since we've got a helicopter flying in the middle of it. But, you know, you can see this is very, very flat land, right? So the river is there in the distance, you know, back here. And the result of this is a little bit of water goes into the rivers during the flooding season, and the whole area gets put underneath water. So, you know, most of the homes in this area here are not like the ones that you and I have, you know, that are, you know, made out of brick or wood. These ones are, you know, they're made out of sticks, and they're made out of, you know, grass huts almost in many places, and that's not going to stand up to flooding on a constant basis. So it's not a very safe place to live if you're not really, like, fortified. You know, you get like a Three Little Pigs situation here, you know. You don't want to build your house out of straw, and you don't want to build your... Well, how did the other guy build it? Straw and sticks? Is the second guy sticks? Yeah, straw, sticks, and the third guy builds his out of bricks. You really want to be built out of bricks. So if we look here, we'll see this entire area has become flooded, and this is not completely unusual in India even today. And this has been going on now for thousands of years. So that's a problem. That makes this place a very, very difficult piece of land to live in. Okay, so this guy here, his home in the background is made out of bricks. That's a little bit better. So it's not going to necessarily wash away unless you get the worst flood possible. But he's got himself a little raft here. He knows, you know, this is going to happen. Here's how I get around when this does occur. So flooding in India, very, very common. And then you got this character here. The bottom right, you can see that flash flooding is a big concern. When it begins to flood in rain, you know, those waters will really multiply themselves very, very quickly, and you get like a flash flood situation where there's way more water than you'd ever predict flowing through a river. And then here's this guy down here who thinks, well, I'll just stand at the bank and record it with my cell phone. Probably not the best idea he's ever had. Hopefully nothing bad happened to him after this, but if it did, you might want to say he deserved it. The top left, you'll see just the height of what these waters can get. So elephants are native to India as well. So, you know, as they're kind of walking around and doing their daily thing, they'll find themselves, you know, surrounded by water too every once in a while. We can see that, you know, this water here has gotten about as high as an elephant's eye, as we like to say. So the flooding causes big, big problems in both ancient and modern-day India as well. You can't stop the rain. All right, taking a look at a couple photos here. You got this guy here who is trying to bring his bike somewhere. And he's just tall enough to make sure the water doesn't go up his nose and he can still breathe. That seems like a fairly dangerous game. I don't really understand it. Frankly, once he gets there, how's he going to ride his bike anyway? I don't know. And then in the bottom left there, you got people just making their way around town, through the floodwaters. So it's a fairly common occurrence in both ancient and modern India to have to deal with flooding on a regular basis throughout the year. These two photos here show you the devastation that flash flooding in India can bring. So this area here at one point was a road and a bridge that crossed a river and brought two sides of a town together. That roadway and the bridge have been completely washed away. So these are the foundations of the bridge that crossed here, and it's gone. There's nothing left of it. The power of water is just amazing. The way it can just come through and just destroy the things that man have take years for them to build in seconds. And then you see the roadway has been washed away back here, along with some homes and buildings that were constructed along the side of the river, the bank. Those have been destroyed as well. The bottom right-hand side here shows flooding from an aerial view. Just very, very devastating. And this is, again, happening both in ancient times and today. If you look there, those are a couple websites that, that give you some news articles and videos showing recent flooding and devastation that's taking place in India. Typically, I'll show these to my classes. If you wish to go ahead and pull those up yourself, each video is only about 30 or 90 seconds. It's not that long. You can go ahead and just type those into your browser, and that'll open up some old BBC stories for you, just to give you an idea of what the flooding, the devastation looks like, in today's India. And you would have seen a lot of the same in ancient India as well. So the weather causes big problems, bigger problems than invasion potentially has for you. So and that is because of some weather patterns called monsoons. So when we say monsoons, we typically think of rain. Oh man, it's raining so hard out there, it's like a monsoon. Well, that's partly true, but monsoons are not necessarily rainstorms. Monsoons are seasonal winds. Now, sometimes the monsoons will bring wet rain. And then you can say, oh, it's so raining hard, it's like a monsoon out there. And you're right. But sometimes the monsoons don't bring wet rain, but sometimes they bring dry air, and they'll dry out an area too. So monsoons are not rains. Monsoons are wind patterns. So in India, there are two main wind patterns that kind of flow across the continent, the subcontinent, on a yearly basis. So in the winter, they've got these winds, that are monsoons, that blow dry air from the northern areas and then down and across this zone. So this H means a high. So I'm not a meteorologist and this isn't a science class, but when you have high pressure, that's when you have fair weather. And when you have low pressure, that's when you have bad weather. So if you've ever had one of those little gauges in your home that tells you the barometric pressure, and it'll say, if the barometric pressure is getting lower, then that means the weather is about to change and turn poor, and if the barometric pressure is higher, then the weather is about to be fair and clear. Well, that's the same idea here. So in the wintertime, there's a high pressure area over top of India, and that high pressure blows dry air across India. And that means that they don't get a lot of rain and they don't get a lot of flooding. However, during the spring, the direction of the wind changes and the wind is blowing in across the ocean into India. And that is a low pressure area that's bringing moist air from the ocean. So the hot, dry air is coming from north of India over the mountains. So there's not a lot of moisture in that air. However, in the spring, the air isn't coming from that direction. It's coming from the ocean. The ocean obviously provides a lot of moisture to the air above it. So when that air blows over top of India, it's going to rain. And that's when you get the seasonal flooding. So it brings a lot of rain. That rain causes flooding, which you can predict. It's not completely unpredictable. You know when the monsoons are going to come. But at the same time, they can still cause problems. Just because it's about to flood, that doesn't mean you can stop it. You have to, kind of be prepared and know that it's time to, kind of peace out. So taking a look here, we'll see down here the winter monsoon. Again, monsoon just means a windstorm. It doesn't necessarily mean, rain. During the winter time, the high, which means the fair, dry weather, is located to the north of the Indian subcontinent, and it blows kind of like south, southeast, southwest. So it's blowing dry air across India. Over here, we're seeing the spring and summertime, right? The low is actually located here, and it's blowing wet, moist air across India, and once it falls, it's coming to come down as rain. So moist summer and spring monsoons, that's what brings rain, and the dry wintertime monsoon, those airs bring hot, dry air. So again, monsoons are not rainstorms. Monsoons are wind patterns, okay? Half of the year, they're bringing dry, warm air. The other half of the year, they're bringing warm, wet air. Okay, typically we would go ahead and we would do this map assignment together where we would locate these places on our map of India: the Himalayan mountains, the Hindu Kush mountains, the Indus River, the Ganges River, the Indian Ocean, and the Deccan Plateau. So usually I would just throw this up on the board and I would, you know, kind of color these in with you, and we would go ahead and try to put them on the map together. A little difficult to do since I'm on the other side of this computer, so maybe I can go ahead and color them in myself and you can kind of follow along. Okay, for this map exercise, we're going to go ahead and use one of the oldest and most practical programs Microsoft ever came up with, and that's Microsoft Paint. So we'll go ahead and open Paint, and what I have here in front of me is the same map that you have in the PowerPoint, and if you're in class, you should have in front of you as well. So when we do a map activity, I like to locate the mountain ranges that are important, the rivers, the oceans that are important, and then highlight them using colored pencils or markers or whatever it is that you have with you. So let's go ahead and do this together. I'll do my best to kind of keep it clear, and then you can go ahead and make one for yourself as well. So we'll start by labeling the ocean, which is the easiest one to find. So India itself is surrounded on three sides by the Indian Ocean. So what we'll go ahead and do is just label this over here, Indian Ocean. I'm going to type it. You, however, can write it in. So, put an Indian Ocean on both the east and the west side of India to show that that ocean does surround India on both sides. Now let's go ahead and let's find the other bodies of water that are important, and that's the rivers. So for this, I'm going to go ahead and switch to the paintbrush tool, and we'll use blue for this. I'm going to go ahead and highlight first the Indus River. So you're doing this as well. This purpose here, we're going to follow the northernmost track of the river and highlight that. Don't worry about those other two branches there. Let's focus on this one. So we go ahead and color that in. And then we're going to go ahead and label that the Indus River as well. Next, we'll go ahead and find and label the Ganges River. So, get our brush back out, highlight this river. There we go. And let's go ahead and name that the Ganges River. Very good. Now, in the middle of India, you've got this raised plateau area that's called the Deccan Plateau. So the Deccan Plateau is an area of higher elevation in the middle of India. So we'll go ahead and label that as well. It's right here in the center of India. And we're just going to write Deccan Plateau. Just like that. Then click off of that. Next, what we want to find are the mountain ranges that are important for India. So we said that India is surrounded to the north by two important mountain ranges. The first, the tallest in the world, the Himalayas, and then the Hindu Kush. So let's start with the Himalayas. So when I do mountain ranges, I typically make them like, you know, little triangles like this. Okay, so that's what we're going to go ahead and do. Only we're going to put the Himalayas in the right place. Ballpark. Here we go. How big these mountains are. And then we're going to go ahead and label those the Himalayan mountains. The other mountain chain that we've got to identify, that's the Hindu Kush. So we'll do the same thing. We'll come back, get ourselves the paintbrush out. I like to make my mountains red so they kind of stand out a little bit better. Let's go ahead and make our Hindu Kush mountains like this. And then we'll go ahead. We'll label those. There we go. So, just to recap, make sure we've got this clean. First, we've got India surrounded on three sides by the Indian Ocean. So we've labeled Indian Ocean here and here to show that it is surrounded on both sides by the Indian Ocean because it's a peninsula. Next, we've identified the rivers. So we've got the Indus River. We've highlighted it in blue. And then we've got the Ganges River. And we've gone ahead and we've highlighted that in blue as well. We've labeled each, the Indus and the Ganges. Then the top of India, the northern area there, is kind of closed off by mountains. So in that case, we've labeled the Himalayas and the Hindu Kush. So the Himalayas are located here, and then you've got the Hindu Kush located here. So we've got our mountains located, we've got two mountain chains, we've got two rivers that we've located, and then we've got one ocean, and then one plateau region here in the center of India. So what I'd like you to do is, if you're following along, go ahead and make your map look like mine. Okay, that's the conclusion of part one of India, the Subcontinent and its People. This lesson continues in parts two and three, both of which you can find on my website, mrleap.weebly.com. Check out mrleap.weebly.com for all of my lessons, including links to these videos, the PowerPoints, and the associated notes, or you can shoot me an email by finding me at mrleap.weebly.com. Until next time, be true to yourself and follow your bliss. Yeah!